Belinda presents this unabridged recording of A Little Give, the unsung, unseen, undone work of women, written and read by Marina Benjamin. For the cleaners and the carers. When we speak of housework, we are not speaking of a job as other jobs, but we are speaking of the most pervasive manipulation, the most subtle and mystified violence that capitalism has ever perpetrated against any section of the working class. Silvia Federici wages against housework. There are those who want only the best, and those who believe only the best is immoral. I would talk about these two impulses, one for comfort, the other for justice, and how one appears animal, the other not that animal at all. Anne Boyer, Garments Against Women. Cleaning. The sharp, sweet hit of ammonia is unmistakable. It prickles the nostrils like something administered for a faint, and once I detect it, I smell it everywhere. Urine gone stale. Standing at the kitchen sink, arms deep in dirty dishes, I twist my head away from the most obvious offender, a dirty grey dishcloth balled up behind the faucet. But now stinging fumes of ammonia are rising up from every surface like swamp mist. Everything is suspect. The grimed up lino flooring, the rag-headed mop propped against the back door, the stiffened mat beneath my feet. My aunt, I realise, is incontinent. Beyond the kitchen window, the plum tree at the end of the garden is in bud. I think about the jam G would make if we were to return at the end of summer and gather up an overripe cash in juice-stained paper bags. I picture him at the stove, stirring bubbling goo, purple on the wooden spoon, filling the house with wafts of boiled fruit. In the years gone by, Aunt Marta would have brought the plums round herself, along with a variety of cotton wool swaddled plant cuttings that she'd instruct us to graft into our small city garden. But Marta hasn't left the house in almost 2 years. Next door in the living room, my mother sits with her, muttering quietly, the conversation a one-way affair. Every now and then she strokes her sister's impassive hand. It used to be that Marta was the big personality, blowing into our house like a tempest, trailing cigarette smoke, regaling us with her latest triumphs and derelictions, upbraiding an errant neighbour, tearing up a parking ticket right in front of the idiot meter man, her eyes alive with mischief. The raw energy she brought with her, its beasting brace. But my aunt has been mute for months. I lean back from the sink and hold my yellow gloves aloft, dripping soap suds, to peer through the small rectangular hatch with sliding plastic panes that connects the two rooms. And I see them there, my aunt ensconced in her faded orange armchair, slippered feet planted stolidly in front of her, my mother on the sofa next to her. Their knees are touching, and this moves me in a way I find hard to articulate. There's something about the cargo of the shared past they carry between them that's impressed within this physical contact. A bond so intense it's almost twinship. For a brief moment, I picture them as they once were, young women impatient for their lives to begin, eager to know what lay ahead. Dressed in white shirts and full skirts tightly belted at the waist in the 1950s style, they're leaning over the railing of the ocean liner that would sweep them away from Jewish Baghdad forever. Faces turned to the wind. My mother, a gamine creature with a flick of black hair falling over her shy eyes. Marta, altogether more va-va-voom. Her Rita Hayworth curls, squashed by the smartly frogged ship's officer's cap that she'd snagged within minutes of boarding and wore at a tilt. I cannot catch any of my mother's words, just their sound, like water slipping over stones. But Marta regards her with adoring, child-wide eyes, and for a flickering moment I'm convinced that recognition is still there. But if it is, it is trapped inside a brain too demented to return anything. What I'm surveying resembles a still-life painting. The projection of intimacy is all my own. In 3 hours' time, I'm meant to be at the National Theatre. I could walk away from this suburban kitchen right now and my aunt would be none the wiser. But the drag I feel in my bones tells me that walking away is not an option. I feel the need to honour her, to offer some tribute to her personhood before it is completely eroded by brain rot, to restore, if not exactly her dignity, then at least some version of order. By way of erecting a symbolic shrine built of formica and lino and corrugated plastic and dedicating it to the woman she once was, I will make her kitchen gleam. Opening cupboards one by one, I find the tools I need. Bleach, floor cleaner, J-cloths, paper towels, anti-mold spray, window cleaner, lime descaler, wipes, scrubbing sponges. I will not be using the rag-headed mop. And I begin. This is devotional work, executed out of love and filial duty, appreciation and grief. Payback for the care my aunt showered on me growing up. Jumping in to take my side in my endless altercations with my mother. Driving me home across London at manic speeds on nights when I'd changed my mind about sleeping over. A fag in her mouth, her shoulders hunched over the steering wheel in concentration. She was always carrying sweets, always conspiratorial, always up for some childish fun. As I clean, I feel my heart lighten. Scraping caked-on food off the counter, spritzing windows and taps, the sticky hob, the nicotine-stained cupboard doors. Grabbing a bin bag, I waltz it open and fill it with food gone bad in the fridge. I get the worst of the sticky grime off the floor with boiling water and bleach. Then I douse a fat sponge with liquid cleaner and adopt a strange half-squat that lets me take large arcing sweeps at the floor without having to get down on my knees. I push aside niggling thoughts of Marta idly surveying me, waving a lazy hand and saying, "Why bother?" A reluctant cook, indifferent to dirt, her kitchen was never clean. And yet my urge is to pick up after her, brush away the scattered pieces, tidy any evidence that might betray her broken mind. An hour later, the kitchen is transformed. It even smells clean. So why do I feel soiled, as though dirt degradation and dementia were somehow catching? I want to leave a physical marker, a totem of shiny pots and pans, a cairn. I want to bequeath a commemorative gift that says care has been lavished here. This is why people set vases of fresh-cut flowers on the kitchen table. It's an invitation to pause and smell the air, to understand that something good lives in this atmosphere. But there are no flowers here, only a row of forlorn-looking cacti on the shelf under the window, wobbly in their powdery earth. I water them as if spilling blood. Next door, my mother is saying, "We need to head home now, Marta, but I'll call you tomorrow. And don't worry, we'll be back in a couple of weeks." She says, "You have Elise to look after you in the meantime." Elise is a Montenegrin woman of statuesque proportions and hypermobile expressiveness. She lives in Ashford with her two teenage sons and drives up to Shepperton every day to cook for Marta. Arriving as we are readying to leave, she bustles in carrying plastic bags and Tupperware containers. She towers over us, bestowing greetings and hugs, her features beaming. "Hello, darling," she calls out to Marta from the hall before heading to the kitchen to unpack soup and bread and fig Newtons. She will stay all afternoon, make Marta an evening meal, read aloud to her a dozen or so pages from a history book or detective novel, and watch TV, talking back to the newscasters while Marta sits silently by. Then she'll help Marta up to her narrow bed and turn out the lights. Until the next day. "Oh my God, a fairy has come and made magic," Elise says as she walks into the shining kitchen, putting a thick hand to her eyes as if to shield them from the unexpected glare. It's a clever thing to say. She means that I have not abased myself by doing menial work, work that she understands to be beneath me, and also beneath her, since she never stoops to do it, the line between cleaner and carer being a defining demarcation. Instead, my work is fairy dust and glitter, a wand waved rather than demeaning labour. I am a benevolent sprite. At the theatre, running, I manage to claim my seat moments before the curtain rises. I am agitated. I'm convinced that I stink of wee. My daily life and Marta's spool out across parallel worlds, the distance between them never more palpable than in this instant when our differences are so rudely exposed, and the breach has left me discomforted. The play is about vigilantes organising under the negligent eye of a corrupt leadership in Pakistan in the early 1980s, seeding what would soon become the Taliban. In the interval, I sip wine with G and a friend and talk politics and feel my grip on my own life returning. As we talk, the fumes of ammonia, detergent and bleach gradually lift and dissipate into my surrounds. My agitation is diluted. I am one part in a million. A speck of dust. In a single moment, I see myself as others might see me, a dogged woman squatting on the kitchen floor, skirt hitched up around her thighs, head pressed forward, one hand splayed on the tiles for balance. The other hand, the left, is making determined circular passes across one of the tiles, scrubbing it clean with a baby wipe. In this moment, I exist on multiple planes. I see myself from the outside, and I think, this is madness, this crazed cleaning of an already clean floor. I think that a middle-aged woman on her knees in the kitchen has lost the plot, or lost herself, or is lost in a task of such meaninglessness that it must offer some meditative balm. Inside my head, thoughts flutter about, come to rest for a second and assume definite shape, then flutter off again. All the work of the hand is rooted in thinking, Heidegger wrote. The hand does not only grasp and catch or push and pull. The hand reaches and extends, receives and welcomes. The hand carries. The hand designs and signs. Heidegger was talking about handiwork, the dignity of making things. He was talking about an artisanship rooted in skill and learning. Cleaning does not qualify. It is mindless work. In cleaning, even the hand is dumb. Down on the floor in the kitchen, I think only lonely thoughts. I think, look at this tile, strafed with solvent so powerful that can remove gloss paint from slate. I consider the wipe in my hand and I think, this solvent is so potent. Imagine what it could do to a baby's bottom. 1. Housework is an activity that erases itself. By that I do not mean that it is undone, because it is in the entropic nature of things to tend towards chaos, although that too is true. I mean that the success of housework turns on its invisibility, on the quiet conspiracy of the women who do it, and then hide the fact of its doing, denying the physicality of their own labour. 2. In grand Victorian households, the servant women who were paid to do housework were supposed to be invisible. Concealed behind the walls, they moved through the many storied houses they upkept, using a labyrinth of back passages, narrow corridors, and separate stairways, ferrying clean piles of linens and gleaming soup tureens from one room to another in the company of spiders and rodents. By night, they melted into the air, disappearing into unloved attics. 3. Sometimes the hidden is fetishized. The Swedish-Italian artist, Linda Fregnina, works with anonymous found photographs dating from the 19th century and assembles them into meaningful archives. Her book, The Hidden Mother, contains more than 1,000 studio-made portrait pictures of infants in which the mother's presence, a functional necessity to hold the babies still during long exposure times, has been crudely obliterated. Either a blanket has been thrown over her body, or her head is bandaged up inside a scarf, or she's squatting unseen behind a chair. Sometimes only a supporting hand is visible. In other pictures, the negative was scratched or burned to leave a blackened gouge where the mother's head should be. The images are uncanny, violent, disturbing. Perhaps the intent is to foreground the child, in keeping with an ethos that rewards wives and mothers for producing clean houses and washed children without ever taking credit for them. The mothers must stay in the background, unseen. However, not seeing these mothers relies on the viewer willfully ignoring the cloth-covered lump in the middle of the frame.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.